This is Duke University.
Thank you. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Welcome to this service of worship at Duke University Chapel. We pray that this will be a place where you encounter God today. Following worship this morning, the congregation invites you to join us on the front lawn for lemonade and to learn more about the variety of ministries and opportunities that we offer. We would love you to come out and learn some about the ways you can get involved in the life of our church. This afternoon at 4 p.m., the chapel choir, along with the Choral Society of Durham, the Duke Chorale, and the Vespers Ensemble, they'll be presenting and performing the Mozart Requiem as a September 11th commemoration concert. The concert is free to everyone, and you all are welcome to come. Our worship today will begin with a commemoration of those who died in the attacks on September 11th, 2001. There will be a procession of white roses, each one representing 100 people who died in the attacks, and blue roses, each one representing one of the 6 alum from Duke University who died on that day. Please stay seated during the commemoration, and the choir director will indicate when it's time to stand to join in the opening hymn.
Thank you. us, perverse and foolish, oft we've strayed, yet in his love he seeks us. God knows the whole of our lives, and that we aren't always as put together as we appear. Let us confess our failings to our gentle shepherd. Merciful Creator, we hear your voice, yet we do not follow. Lord, have mercy. Compassionate Savior, we prefer to turn to anger and violence rather than seeking to listen or understand. Christ, have mercy. Gracious Spirit, we say a lot about you with our words, but it doesn't show in our lives. Lord, have mercy. May the King of Love, whose mercy never fails, draw you to himself, cleanse you from all of your sins, and strengthen you to live in the power of the Holy Spirit. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. As a forgiven and reconciled people, let us share signs and words of Christ's peace.
Please join me in the prayer for illumination printed in your bulletin. God of constant mercy, who sent your Son to save us, as we hear your word today, remind us of your goodness, increase your grace within us, so that our thankfulness may grow. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. The first lesson is from Genesis, the second chapter. In the day that the Lord God made the earth and the heavens, when no plant of the field was yet in the earth, and no herb of the field had yet sprung up, for the Lord God had not caused it to rain upon the earth, and there was no one to till the ground, but a stream would rise from the earth and water the whole face of the ground. Then the Lord God formed man from the dust of the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and the man became a living being. And the Lord God planted a garden in Eden in the east, and there he put the man whom he had formed. Out of the ground the Lord God made to grow every tree that is pleasant to the sight and good for food, the tree of life also in the midst of the garden, and the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. This is the word of the Lord.
Thank you.
The New Testament lesson is from Romans, the 14th chapter. Welcome those who are weak in faith, but not for the purpose of quarreling over opinions. Some believe in eating anything, while the weak eat only vegetables. Those who eat must not despise those who abstain, and those who abstain must not pass judgment on those who eat, for God has welcomed them. Who are you to pass judgment on servants of another? It is before their own Lord that they stand or fall, and they will be upheld, for the Lord is able to make them stand. Some judge one day to be better than another, while others judge all days to be alike. Let all be fully convinced in their own minds. Those who observe the day, observe it in honor of the Lord. Also, those who eat, eat in honor of the Lord, since they give thanks to God, while those who abstain, abstain in honor of the Lord and give thanks to God. We do not live to ourselves, and we do not die to ourselves. If we live, we live to the Lord. And if we die, we die to the Lord. So then, whether we live or whether we die, we are the Lord's. For to this end Christ died and lived again, so that he might be Lord of both the dead and the living. Why do you pass judgment on your brother or sister? Or you, why do you despise your brother or sister? For we will all stand before the judgment seat of God. For it is written, "As I live, says the Lord, every knee shall bow to me, and every tongue shall give praise to God." So then, each of us will be accountable to God. This is the word of the Lord.
Thank you. The gospel lesson is from Matthew, the 18th chapter. Then Peter came and said to Jesus, "Lord, if another member of the church sins against me, how often should I forgive? As many as 7 times?" Jesus said to him, "Not 7 times, but I tell you 70 times 7. For this reason, the kingdom of heaven may be compared to a king who wished to settle accounts with his slaves. When he began the reckoning, one who owed him 10,000 talents was brought to him, and as he could not pay, his lord ordered him to be sold, together with his wife and children and all his possessions, and the payment to be made. So the slave fell on his knees before him, saying, 'Have patience with me, and I will pay you everything.' And out of pity for him, the lord of that slave released him and forgave him the debt. But that same slave, as he went out, came upon one of his fellow slaves who owed him 100 denarii. And seizing him by the throat, he said, 'Pay what you owe.' Then his fellow slave fell down and pleaded with him, 'Have patience with me, and I will pay you.' But he refused. Then he went and threw him into prison until he should pay the debt. When his fellow slaves saw what had happened, they were greatly distressed, and they went and reported to their lord what had taken place. Then his lord summoned him and said to him, 'You wicked slave, I forgave you all that debt because you pleaded with me. So do not have the mercy on your fellow slave, as I had mercy on you?' And in anger, his lord handed him over to be tortured until he should pay his entire debt. So my heavenly Father will also do to every one of you if you do not forgive your brother or sister from your heart." This is the word of the Lord.
Of the living God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Please be seated. The term ground zero is not an ancient phrase that goes back to America's founding fathers, but neither did it enter the dictionary on 9/11. The term ground zero was first used during the Manhattan Project that planned the deadly bombing of Japan. The fearsome weapons dropped on Hiroshima and Nagasaki in 1945 killed around 200,000 civilians. After the Manhattan Project and its apocalyptic climax, Ground Zero came to mean that part of the ground situated immediately under an exploding bomb. Since 9/11, Ground Zero has come to refer to the site in New York City, where a rather different Manhattan Project turned airplanes into guided missiles and left over 2,500 people dead. All of us know exactly where we were when we heard or saw the news. All of us experienced shudders of disbelief, panic, bewilderment, and horror, a sense of something new and mesmerizing and terrifying. Of all the distressing images of that terrible day, one of the most poignant and disturbing is the quantity of dust that was generated. When you watch the towers collapse, the first thing you see is an upsurge of dust and ash coming out of the descending buildings. That dust remained in the air for days and weeks, even years afterwards. And residents of New York City couldn't avoid it in the air they breathed. When you appreciate that around half of those who died in the Twin Towers were not afterwards in any way identifiable in the remains, you realize with horror the incinerated lives that made up so much of that dust. The original Manhattan Project went out into the desert of New Mexico in June 1945 and tested the world's first nuclear weapon. The code name for the spot chosen for the explosion was Zero. Out of the dust of the desert, out of zero, came the project of death. The Manhattan Project and the obliteration of Hiroshima and Nagasaki that resulted put an end to the war in the Pacific. That war had begun with the Japanese attack on Pearl Harbor in 1941. Responding to Pearl Harbor led 4 years later to zero, to the dust of the New Mexico desert, and to the use of nuclear weapons. Nuclear weapons were a new development in the history of warfare. They changed everything. They opened the door to the killing of defenseless civilians in almost unimaginable numbers. For the 4.5 decades of the Cold War, the NATO powers pointed such weapons in the direction of the Soviet Union and Eastern Europe. They did so because it was believed communism posed a fundamental threat to the identity and integrity of the West in general and America in particular. So great was the fear of the Soviet Union that there was a consensus behind going to almost any lengths to withstand its advance. Ronald Reagan called his adversary the evil empire, a designation that elevated political rivalry to the status of religious zeal. Reagan also maintained communism would soon be consigned to the ash heap of history, a claim that seemed to have come true a few years later when the Soviet Union imploded and the Cold War came to an end. But out of the dust and ashes of the Cold War, two things happened without many Westerners noticing. One was that the nature of warfare had quietly changed. The one war that everyone was obsessed with for 50 years and that finally never happened was a war between nation states, the Soviet Union on one side and the United States on the other. In the 15 years following the end of the Cold War, there were no fewer than 118 armed conflicts worldwide, and yet only 7 of them were the old-fashioned kind in which one state fought against another. The rules of war had changed almost overnight. War is no longer something fought by soldiers on a foreign field. In the last generation, of the casualties of war have been mostly civilians, and their killers have usually been citizens of their own country. Part of the outrage of terrorism is that it seems terrorists are taking cruel advantage of democratic freedoms and not playing by the rules of warfare. But the reality is that the rules of warfare changed some time ago, and almost no one is playing by the old rules anymore. People who say 9/11 changed everything are simply naming the moment when they came face to face with this new reality. The second thing that happened was that a significant body of people in different places around the globe, but especially in the Muslim world, came to regard America very much as America had once regarded the Soviet Union. America had set the precedent for describing its adversary as an evil empire, for arming itself with terrifying and indiscriminate weapons, and for going to almost any lengths to undermine a culture that seemed so deeply to threaten and challenge its own. It turned out that more than one party could play that game. Part of America's strategy had been to support and advance the Mujahideen who fought against the Soviet Union in Afghanistan in the 1980s. Among those who rose to prominence in the Afghan guerrilla war was a young Osama bin Laden. For bin Laden and many people like him, the demise of the Soviet Union didn't dismantle the notion that there was an evil empire that was to blame for all the world's ills. The notion remained, but the name of the culprit simply became America. As America found itself somewhat unexpectedly to be alone as the world's only superpower, it inherited the mantle of being the source of all the world's woes. And this view of America appealed especially to those who saw the world's evils as lying principally in the global political decline of Islam since the 17th century, epitomized by the creation of the State of Israel and the long-term presence of American troops in the dusty desert of Arabia, not far from the holy sites of Mecca and Medina. Such people plotted to consign America to the ash heap of history. And the zeal with which they did so produced a phenomenon almost unprecedented in American history. The attacker who knew that his attack would instantly cost his own life. And not just one lone, perhaps possessed, confused, or unstable attacker. No fewer than 19 hijackers of one unwavering heart and one unswerving mind. It wasn't Islam that attacked America on 9/11. It was 19 single-minded people who turned being anti-American into a whole new religion. America is a country constructed around the idea that it's a wondrous thing for any person, however humble or eccentric, to fulfill his or her own dreams. But what if their dreams are violent, murderous, and destructive on an unprecedented scale? The reality is, it's very difficult to stop them. Every step we make to inhibit them gives us less freedom, less to be proud of about our country, and less space in which to dream. You can't cultivate a freedom worth having without the danger that someone will abuse it. That's the risk of articulating a dream. Someone, sooner or later, will trample on it and reduce it to dust. Painful as it is, it's important today to recognize that the 9/11 hijackers achieved almost exactly what they set out to do. They showed vividly, and in a way no one could ever forget, how profoundly some people in the world resent, detest, and reject American global power and cultural influence. They used the definitive weapon of the new kind of war, a shocking attack upon unwary civilians, so as to achieve maximum casualties. They provoked the leadership of the United States to drastic responses in the dusty heat of Afghanistan, but even more so in the desert dust of Iraq. In internal security, but even more so in the use of torture and indiscriminate imprisonment abroad. And these responses replicated and expanded precisely the kind of arbitrary and overbearing use of power that they'd accused America of in the first place. They concocted a blood-curdling potion that has poisoned the last 10 years of American history. A dizzying cocktail of terror and incomprehension that's induced the most powerful economic and military power in history to adopt the mentality of a wounded and half-crazed lion, breathing vengeance and losing sight of proportionate response, resolved to do whatever it takes to obliterate terror from the earth and thus assuage the memory and the pain of its horrifying scar. And most of all, the 9/11 hijackers left a series of searing visual images that continue to populate America's worst nightmares of sudden horror, hideous carnage, and terrifying destruction. The infinite might of America reduced to zero. An icon of the demise of an evil empire. All Ronald Reagan's evocative imagery turned on its head, the most famous ash heap in history, tower and temple turned to dust. In this chapel, on Ash Wednesday each year, and in millions of churches around the world, Christians line up and mark the beginning of Lent by receiving on their heads a vivid image, an imprint of dust and ashes. And as the ashes are drawn in the shape of the cross on our foreheads, we hear the words, "Remember, you are dust, and to dust you shall return." In the book of Genesis, we are told the Lord God formed man from the dust of the earth and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life. Listen carefully to those words. This is a day to contemplate dust, its horror, its ubiquity, its place in God's purposes. The dust of the earth, the dust of the desert, the dust of trampled dreams, the dust of destroyed buildings, the dust of fire-ravaged bodies, the dust of dead skin, the dust that filled the nostrils of Manhattan on 9/11. This is death, shocking, earthy, unavoidable, overwhelming, mundane. Dust is death. But this is where God began. God made humanity out of this dust. This is ground zero. This is the epicenter of dust. This is where the good news begins. This is where God makes humanity. God formed us from the dust of the earth. God started from zero. When Christ walked the way of the cross, three times he fell under its weight. The freedom God had given the world was abused so badly that it turned to the ultimate perversity of consigning Christ to Calvary. Three times the weight of the world's folly and foolishness and cold-blooded hatred made Christ implode and plummet to the ground. Three times Christ fell into the ash heap of history. Three times Christ bit the dust. But on Easter Day, God remade Christ out of the dust of the earth. Just as on the day of creation, God turned dust and ashes into flesh and blood, God started from zero and built something that truly would last forever. God didn't send 9/11. God doesn't condone the atrocity of 9/11. God doesn't make us for violence or suicide attacks or mass murder or destruction. But hear the words of God, speaking out of the rubble of that dreadful day, whispering to us from the ash heap of history. Remember, you are dust, and to dust you shall return. In other words, go back to the beginning, start from zero. We feel the terror of those poor people on the hijacked planes, facing their imminent death, powerless and panicked, but the truth is, we're all on those planes. We're all going to die. We're all ignorant of our destiny and powerless to prolong our life. We shall all be dust. We live in a beautiful country, flowing with milk and honey. Let's leave aside the fantasies about it being the greatest country or having the most spacious skies. Let's concentrate on being a good country, a faithful country, a country where the poor are respected, the stranger is made welcome, the enemy is treated like a human being, the victim can find justice, and the criminal can find restoration and forgiveness. We feel the horror of that pile of dust at ground zero. But the truth is, we shall all be part of that pile of dust one day. 65 years ago, we had the temerity to create zero, to create destruction so overwhelming that we could reduce a whole metropolitan area to dust at a stroke. 10 years ago today, we saw with horror that we too could become zero. Very suddenly, very cruelly, very painfully. 10 years ago today, we saw that we too are dust, and to dust we shall return. Towers and temples do turn to dust. Our lives will turn to dust. There is no freedom that can ultimately prevent the devious, the determined, and the deranged from creating terror and turning goodness and pretension alike into dust. But all our hope lies in the God who makes beautiful things out of dust, who made us, called Abraham out of the dust of the desert, remade Christ from the dust of the tomb, will remake Manhattan from the dust of ground zero, and will finally make all things new, the God who abides in the dust of Afghanistan, the dust of Iraq, and the dust of Arabia. The God who transforms the dust of our trampled dreams, the God who restores those who repent in dust and ashes, the God who breathes life into nostrils cloyed by dust, the God who lifts us up like a firefighter and carries us home like a shepherd. If only, amid all our anger and self-justification and sadness, if only we can find the humility and the humanity ourselves, slowly and painfully, to start from zero and let God make something beautiful out of even this.
Thank you.
The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Hear our grief, O Lord, our confusion and dismay at this horror, this hatred, this loss of life, this scar upon our souls and our memories. Comfort and sustain those whose lives continue to be dominated by that day. Be close to those who lost loved ones, all who sustained lasting injuries, any who saw things they cannot erase from their imaginations and dreams, and those who continue to live and work close to the site of the attacks. Give strength and pride to all whose daily work makes them protectors of the safety of others. Empower firefighters and police officers, paramedics and emergency responders, pilots, flight attendants, air traffic controllers, airport security workers, and all who are subject to the plots and schemes of those determined to cause terror. Bless policymakers with wisdom and understanding, firmness and compassion, grace and a vision of your kingdom. Bring hope and courage to all who serve in military operations and to their families. Bless the people of Afghanistan and Iraq. Restore places and people that have been subject to terrorist attack in the years since 9/11. Shed your hand of forgiveness, reconciliation, and healing on relations between America and the Arab and Muslim world. Continue to raise up Muslim leaders who speak words of peace and common humanity. Give hope and security to American Muslims. Empower all who seek to bring reconciliation between those who have been party to extreme violence and those who have been their victims. Holy God, you create us from the dust of the earth and recreate us in Christ from the dust of death. Turn our grief to truer living, our sadness to firmer hope, and our sorrow to deeper joy. In the power of the Spirit and in union with Christ. Amen. God shapes and fashions us by his grace and invites us to participate in the works of his kingdom through our tithes and offerings. All of today's offering will go to humanitarian agencies within Durham. Let us offer our gifts to God.
Loving God, you create us from zero. You make beauty where we only see death and despair and destruction. You opened your creative life to us through your Son, and what we destroyed and reduced into ashes, you invigorated again in glorious resurrection. We praise you for the life that erupted from your Son's tomb to give us hope and help and healing. Transform us by the glory of Jesus's redeeming life into people of reconciliation and peace. Make all our gifts instruments of your grace, that your love might be the recognizable melody of your church in this land and all over the world. May our offerings gathered here fill Durham with songs of forgiveness, faith, hope, light, joy, and peace, that you may receive all thanks and praise to the glory of your name. Amen. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. May the God who makes beautiful things out of dust make beautiful things out of the ashes of our lives today and forevermore. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.